and welcome to this week's episode of Kim's Upholstery Live, brought to you by Kim's Upholstery, and also on behalf of our friends at Big Duck Canvas, who donated the outside fabric that's on this chair. Each week we share with you a project that we're doing here in our workroom. Sometimes, as this particular one has, it takes several weeks to complete, and other times they're just short projects. But we try to show you everything start to finish so you can get the full idea of what is involved in upholstering. As you come in, we hope you will go ahead and share or like our page if you haven't already liked it, but go ahead and share this feed out with your friends so that we can bring more people in to see what's happening here at Kim's Upholstery. We also encourage you to go ahead and say hello, let us know where you're viewing from, let us know if this is your first time here watching us live, and also if you've got projects you're working on, we would love to hear what you're working on, and if you have questions, feel free to ask questions about the things that I'm doing here, or ask questions about a project you may be working on your own. And we do try to answer all those questions while we're live. Sometimes we miss them because the feed just starts going quickly, and then I will get back to you after the live if I miss them during the live. Sometimes we get some lively conversations going on here too, so that's always fun as well. But again, go ahead and say hello and let us know you are here. Now, this is week 4 of this chair project here. I painted the frame off camera, and we tore it down, and I got the springs all tied and ready for you off camera, but we started putting on the support systems, and the outside fabric was on week 1. So this striped fabric that you see on the exterior of the chair was added from the interior, and if you remember, this is a deconstructed chair, so we're leaving the frame exposed intentionally. And then we added our support system, which was a sagless fabric. You could also use jute webbing, but I usually work with sagless because I just like working with it. I like the way it's easier to apply. It's less work because it's less pieces to attach. And then we moved on to padding and upholstering the insides. So we did the inside arms and then the inside back. For our padding, we used synthetic upholstery cotton. And then we went over it with a final layer of Dacron before adding our decorative fabric. And once we added our decorative fabric, we were trimming it down with a razor blade, I believe last week when we ended the show. And this week, what we're going to do is move on to padding and upholstering the tops of the arms, and then we'll be gluing on our single welt cord. So this particular frame gets a single welt cord instead of a double because there's an indented channel here that the actual selvage of their seam allowance on the single welt will actually sink into. So let's go ahead and check and see who is here today. Hello, Dawn and Sylvia. Thanks for joining us. And Kevin. Oh, and it's jumping already. And hello, Peggy and Candy. And let's see, Susan. Hello, Susan. All right, so you're starting to hop in. I can see the screen moving. So thanks for stopping in and joining us. And I think most of you, the names sound familiar. I think you've watched all 3 episodes before this. So welcome back. And I hope you're as excited as I am to get this project done. And I don't know if I mentioned it, but I have a second chair just like it that has not yet been painted. So I've got to tear that one down and paint it so that I can have my matching set back together. And over on YouTube, we have Kim Delaney here from the UK. Hello, Kim. Thanks for joining us. So let's go ahead and get started. For the top of the arm areas here, I'm going to be padding with cotton and Dacron. Sometimes you'll see these and they're really puffy, and other times they're fairly flat. So it's really a personal taste. But if you're doing a chair for a client and it had a specific look before you started it, you probably want to keep a similar look unless they have requested to you to change it, or unless you've had that conversation with them. You don't want to go and change a lot about a client's chair without first talking to them, because when they get it back, even though it'll look better, there might be something that you did that they don't like. So you just want to make sure you have those conversations with your client before you go ahead and make any changes. So let's start with our cotton, and this is the synthetic cotton that I mentioned. It's a white instead of the natural cotton, which is more of a beigey color. And both are fine to work with. It's whatever you want. I just prefer to work with the synthetic. So I'm going to go ahead and grab my dipple gun. I'm thinking we'll probably do 2 layers of cotton. But we'll see as I go, because this chair is for me, so I can go any direction I want, which obviously the deconstructed was my idea. And it's a little more refined deconstructed than some of what you see out there. Most of the deconstructed that you will see on Pinterest, which is where I get the idea, you actually see the support system from the outside of the chair. So you're seeing the jute webbing. In some cases, you're even seeing the zigzag springs in the back of a piece of furniture. And I wanted it a little more refined so that I had that decorative fabric showing. So I'm just stapling straight down to the top of the arm. So I've got two layers of cotton on there. And I think that with one layer of Dacron is gonna be fine. Let me just kind of finesse the edges here so that I don't have a lot of whiskers hanging down. And I'll probably get a couple staples right in here as well, just to hold that up out of the channels. If I can get my gun and hold it on there without slipping and without stapling my fingers. And I'm going to do the same thing on the outside edge here. And you just want to make sure that you're keeping it out of that channel. And I think I actually might need to move that staple. I think I stapled low enough that some of it's sinking into the channel, which will make it more difficult to get my fabric in there. So let me pop that one staple right here. You're better off to change it right away rather than trying to work with it and ending up later having everything else on top of it and now realizing it's in the way. Of course, finding the staple in the cotton sometimes is another chore. There we go. But there it is. Most of it fell right off, actually. Get that last little sharp point out if I can. There. All right. Staple this back down. Okay, and now I'm going to go ahead and put cotton on the other arm, and then we'll get our Dacron on top of this. Let me just spin this around. And I'm using the striped fabric on these. And I decided the striped fabric because I thought it would show less grubbiness from hands. And I also thought it would hold up better on that particular application than the print fabric. And this is one of those areas where you get to use up some of those scraps you have laying around. A little bit too much on the back side here. So what is everybody else working on? Anybody got any unusual projects or extra special fabrics that you're working with? There are some florals coming out on the market that I absolutely love. I'm liking all the big bold kind of watercolory looking printed florals. All right, so we got a few staples there. We got a couple on the inside. It's gonna be hard for me to stand so you can see this. Let's spin around. There you go. Little bit more off. When you really want to feel it, make sure you're not getting any lumps going on. So hello Red, I see that you said it's gorgeous fabric, thank you. And hello Abby and Joan, thanks for stopping by. And Gina and Abby says, I'm working on tearing down a wing back chair. Lots of staples need pulling. I hope this time, Abby, you're not going to have the same difficulties you had with that faux suede project that you worked on. Hello Sylvia, she says be careful and have fun to Abby. And hello Ann and Ragne. And Red says, oops, I just finished a set of theater seats and am about to start on a porter chair that took months to tear down. Isn't it amazing how much tear down can take for time sometimes? And I did see those theater chairs you were doing, and those are absolutely gorgeous. I love the combinations of prints and the solids that you put together with the velvets and all those bluish and green colors. Hello, Carol. Thanks for stopping in. And Susan Safakis, I'm going to see you on Friday. And Abby says, hope not. Sylvia says, do you plan on putting cording on the outside of the chair as well? Or is that part of the deconstructed? I think I am going to, Sylvia. We'll play with it today and see what we think, but that's my plan. So we'll kind of hold it in there and see what it looks like. Let's see. Ragne says, perfecting boxing cushions. I'm my own worst enemy. Aren't we all? We are our own worst critics for sure. I actually love doing boxed cushions, and I know a lot of people dread doing them. But when you're doing upholstery, almost every project has a cushion. So there we go. Now our crotch is attached. Let me grab my scrap decor that's out of camera shot here.
Laying on the floor,
yes. I threw my pile of stuff on the floor over there. The floor is clean. We did sweep it. So I've got these scraps that I think will be plenty big enough. And this is one of those opportunities that I get to use up my Deconstructed scraps, which is nice. Okay, we're going to go at this end. Give myself a little extra to hang on to rather than running too short. Is this one wide enough as well? Yes. All right, so there are my two pieces of Deconstructed. And at this point, I'm going to, again, be careful not to staple this into the channel. Let's staple it right along the edge above the channel. Actually, leave the smooth edge on the inside. Work with this edge out here that I can cut easier. All right, and this is going to be hard for you to see and have me hold onto it. And that staple kicked back on me. Let me grab my pullers. This wood is really a hard wood, and I've been having a little bit of kickback here and there. Actually, Susan Safakis, you're here. This is the chair that we did in my workroom when I was in the basement for our WCAA group several years back, if you remember it. We did it in a red and tan chenille. Okay, I'm going to be bouncing all over the place here for a minute, so it's going to really be hard for you guys to see everything here. My scissors. Trim a little bit of this excess off in the front here. Pull to the back and I will get this trimmed down. I get the back staple down and then we can finish the rest of the sides. Now I've got a couple staples in the back and the front. We get the very front edge here attached. I'm going to go ahead and work towards the back. Start on the outside and then I'll move to the inside. Kicked back on me again. I actually think I'm going to trim some of this excess off. I want to leave a little bit to hang on to, but got a little bit too much going on there. I am noticing though, if I don't push the gun really firmly against the frame, it is kicking back, so. Back, I just gotta find it. Okay, now I can trim It's good because I can actually ride the blade of the scissor right into the channel that I've got here. Makes it easy to get that cut nice and close. So there you can see, hopefully, that the channel is completely open and debris free. Hello, Tamara and Nora. Nora is from, I live in Moroccan. And she says, nice job. And Jesse says, hello from Bahia. I'm sure I didn't say that right, but I apologize. Bahia? So where is that? My geography is not that good. Bill laughs at me. All right, so now our outside is completely attached and we can go ahead and finish stapling on the inside. And you want to make sure you move your fingers out of the way when you're doing this, because this is easy to staple yourself. You don't need Bill pulling staples out live on camera. That would be out of me I'm talking about. Okay, a couple more towards the back. Pull this a little closer to the front edge here so I can reach it a little better. Okay, I think I kept everything out of the channel there. All right, now let's go ahead and trim that side down. And then we'll be ready to put straight fabric on this side. So I'm just trying to get the scissors in there. Here we go. And if you've ever tried to cut where you've got cotton hanging down, you know how tough it is to get a pair of scissors to cut cotton, which you wouldn't think so. I did my workshop in Colorado. We were putting buttons on the back of a couple of the chairs, and getting the button needle, or the needle to put the buttons on through the cotton sometimes takes a lot of strength and pushing. Okay, that seems pretty cleared out. So now I'll go ahead and put the decor on this side. Start on the back edge here. Actually, let me lock my pedestal here because the spinning freely is not making it easy. That's one good thing about these, is so you can lock them, but I can still turn it if I need to. But at least it's not just flopping around. Right, now bring it down to the sides. And from this angle, actually doing the inside first works well. So I'm gonna turn around this way. So I'm just doing this area here on this arm. So for those of you that are just coming in, and those of you that maybe haven't already, if you could go ahead and hit that share button for us. And there's the air compressor. Share this out on Facebook with everybody, and on YouTube you can use the social shares there as well to share. earlier today we were having troubles with Facebook and wondered if we were going to be able to do this. But everything worked out fine in the end. Just trimming the decon down off the inside here, same as we did on the other arm. And then we will be ready for our fabric and our single well cord. And next week we'll be sewing the cushion. And you can see they got a nice amount of padding, so it's comfortable on your arms, but they're definitely not overstuffed. So has anybody else found a chair that they want to try to do this way? I know, Ragna, you were looking. I'm going to take my challenge to do one. I did learn a couple things on here. Making the cuts for the fabric that's on the inside of the chair and getting them in the right spot was not where I expected it to be. I made all my cuts at the same time, which I wouldn't do that next time, and I made them on the high side, and they actually should have been made on the low side of the post. And if you make your cuts for your inside fabrics to come down, you know what I'm talking about. So I do have a couple little areas where it peaks and you can see some of the stuff from underneath. But it is a deconstructed chair, so I'm okay with it, but there's definitely little things that I learned about doing this that I would do differently on the next chair. Whoa! And don't lose your chair off your pedestal. Now that one's all attached. Fill the decon scissors. Here we go. So now we have both arms padded and we are ready for stripes. So I decided to run the stripes up and down this way, and then that way they match with the outside. You can't really see that from where I am, so that way they match with the outside. I had considered doing this, but I decided I didn't like it running that way, so I wanted to run it this way. But that, again, is a personal preference. I mean, typically with your stripes on anything, they're usually vertical. Every once in a while you'll run into something that's horizontal, but typically you'll find your stripes run vertically. All right, so now, plenty of staples. Go ahead and start stapling in the channel. I'm just going to get a few to start on the outside and then pull on the inside. Now this fun floral fabric was a fabric I have had in my stash for a long time. I bought it when Greenhouse Fabrics was having one of their discontinued sales, and I've been stashing it for quite a while. I was happy to finally find a project for it. But Greenhouse has created a code for you guys if you want to sign up for an account if you don't already have a trade account. And if you use the use Kim's Upholstery, all in capital letters, they will send you some free books. And Greenhouse Fabrics was one of my very first, or was my very first fabric vendor 20 some odd years ago now. And when I got my first box of books from them back then, it was like a party in a box. And they just made me feel like part of the family, and they still do. And when I opened my books, there was a signed picture from everybody on staff saying, "Welcome to Greenhouse." And there were streamers in the box. I don't know if they do that anymore, but I know they do other stuff. But they are really a great company to work with. All right, so I'm just slowly working to the front, and then I'm going to create my pleats. Getting to the back here. Now we also have, I don't know if any of you saw, I posted out earlier today, we only have 2 spots left in our Kingsboro, Mass. Workshop that we have coming up in November. So if anybody's interested in that, I have created an event page here on Facebook. You can go check that out. And I just opened registration last night for the Lottie, California workshop in March of 2019, and we already have signups, so we only have 4 spots left in that. And I know everybody's been emailing me and messaging me for the 2019 schedule, and it will be out there soon, but the registrations will not actually open until next year for most of those. On the March one, I did open to give people plenty of time to plan their projects. And I know, Sylvia, you've already got your chair picked out. You got your fabric picked out. And I did get your email on the fabric, Sylvia, and yes, you can go ahead and send me an email on that. It was hectic today, so I didn't get a chance to respond to you yet. And Bill's actually posting the link for you guys to go ahead and check out the workshops. Okay, that table bounced back up again. And now I'm like sticking the nose as deep in the channel as I can, the nose of the staple gun. And this is one of those situations, I think we talked about this last week, where the long nose is a definite necessity for a project like this. Because the short noses are just too short and they're usually chunkier. All right, so we are stapling around the edges. Let's go ahead and figure out where our fabric wants to pleat. So what do I tell you guys to do with the fabric when you're trying to do stuff like this? What does it say? It says, Kim, fold me here. Can you hear it? You listening? Did you hear it say that? I know, I'm a little crazy, but that's okay. That time I think it said ouch because I stapled it. Hello, Karen and Sandra. Carol says, is your little pink stool a seat of an office chair? Yes, it is, Carol. It's a seat of an office chair with the back taken off. And it is the best thing. I had a chair that kept falling over. Every time I sat in it, it wanted to flip over when I got up. So I took the back off, it turned it into a stool, and it has been wonderful. Okay, Kim, what'd you do with it? Here it is. Okay, the fabric's talking back to me now. There we go. All right, so now we have our 2 pleats at the front. We're done almost all the way to the back, and I'm gonna go ahead and finish the back side. So I was thinking about this project today before we went live. And if you figure, I've been doing, this is week number 4, so I've been working on this chair 1 hour a week with you guys, and I might off camera do something that takes a few minutes. I also figured out my pattern match off camera and did, you know, planned my cuts. So you figure, as of right now, we've got just over 3 hours live into this project, and then probably 2 hours off camera that I've done so far between, you know, the cushion cutting out and stuff. So this is a really great beginner project. We have a lot of questions in our community with new members and people that are thinking of becoming members. And the worst thing people do sometimes is pick out chairs for their first projects that are nothing but frustration. You don't want to start doing projects that are above your skill set and just get yourself so frustrated. And also, if you're taking on projects for family and friends like that, you're just going to end up with a bad result. You're not going to have a comfortable experience because you're worried about wrecking it, and you're above your skill set. So start with a project that really is within your skill set and capabilities and build up that experience. Don't start off right out the box with a tufted chair or a wingback chair or even a channel back chair. You know, start with something that's either got, you know, like a wooden armchair, or something like this piece. It's got the springs in the seat, which give you that experience to the 8-way tie, but it doesn't have a lot of other complicated things, and it gives you just a good feel, and then you'll have results which you can be proud of. Hello, Joanne, thanks for hopping in, and Kathy says, who is the manufacturer of the new fabrics you just mentioned? I mentioned greenhouse fabrics. I'm not sure if that's what you're talking about, but greenhouse fabrics is where I got this fabric on the inside, but I know it's been discontinued. Abby says, when sewing vinyl fabric, what is the best thread to use? If it's for outdoor use, Abby, you want to use a UV rated thread. And the one I have used and like the most is the one that SailRite has. I think it's called the number 92, if I remember correctly. If anybody else knows what that thread number is, go ahead and post it for Abby. But it's from SailRite. I've tried several different ones that I have not liked. I found some of the brands actually like the thread frays, so you end up with this powder everywhere, and I didn't like that, but the one from SailRite was really great. Hey, Tony, thanks for stopping in. And Karen says, is this a project for a customer or just for demonstration? I didn't know deconstructed furniture was a thing. This is for me, so I'm my client. So no, it's not for a client. And I've been watching these deconstructed pieces evolve over the last couple of years and been dying to try one. And Bill's not quite sure he likes this yet, but although I think it's growing on him. Is it growing on you?
Yeah, I like it.
You like it?
But yours is different. You don't have any of the old stuffing sticking out of the side
Yeah.
and all that, you know, which is what I think of when you're doing deconstructed.
Yeah, when you think of the deconstructed, you may have seen some of the older pictures where they left all the old burlap and stuff on the inside, so that's what you saw from the exterior, and you may have seen zigzag springs down the back, but I wanted a more refined look. So I don't know if it's a thing, but it's a thing for me. And Sylvia says, I love your videos, but being live is good. Get to see the full process in real time. Good. And Abby says, I just purchased 2 salon chairs. I can't wait to make my table. Bill's giving you a thumbs up, Abby. And Abby, coming onto the membership, Bill just created a video tutorial on how to do that, because we've had some questions on the fabric. Sorry, I was chasing a fuzz. We've had some questions on that, so that will be coming out in the membership before too long. And hello, Bonnie and Gina. And Kathy says, Abby Connell, where did you get them? Kathy, actually, if you go to beauty parlors and mention to them that you're looking for them, oftentimes they have some stashed away that they have taken off the floor because they were damaged fabric or whatever, and instead of having them reupholstered, they get new ones, and they cannot get rid of them very easily. Also, I have seen them on like Craigslist and some of the marketplaces here on Facebook. So Peggy says, are you going to blade the extra cloth on the arm? I'm assuming you mean cut it off with a razor blade, and yes, I am. Abby loves the arm fabric. Kathy says the new watercolor large prints coming out. Yeah, I love them. They're from Greenhouse, some of the ones I've seen. Polyester 92. Thank you, Darius. So polyester 92, Abby, is the fabric that the thread that I was talking about. Hello, Rhonda. Rhonda was just finishing up her chair that she started at the workshop. I saw the pictures. It looks really good. All right, the fabric is telling me, pleat me here. Did you hear it? You guys, see it said it again. We still got one arm to go, don't we? All right, so let's go ahead and get some of this razor blade off, and then I will go do the other arm. And Kim, what did you do with your razor blade? Stay there.
So we have somebody over on YouTube asking what staple gun you're using.
Okay, so on YouTube, let's see. I can't see who's asking, but it's a long nose Fasco staple gun. So Fasco has, I don't know if these orange ones are even current or not, but these
That's
are both
Fasco.
Huh?
That's not a Fasco.
Did I grab the wrong gun?
Nice
I did
place.
Grab the wrong gun. Okay. This one's the Fasco. So these are both Fascos. I don't know what color they have now. I think the blue is the newer one, if I remember correctly, but it's the Fasco long nose. You want the one that takes the 22 gauge upholstery staples. Because they have different gauge staples that they take. Some of them are bigger, and some of them are made for different kinds of fabrication and not upholstery, but Fasco, which is F-A-S-C-O, and you want a long nose.
But the tack-wise is a really good staple.
That's true. Tack-wise, actually, which was this one that I pulled, is a great staple. They're made in the UK. They're a little bit heavier weight-wise, but they work really, really well. And I actually like this one. I use this one a lot. So TACWISE.
Well,
you can buy them through Amazon.
Well, they're easily available overseas, not so easily available in the States.
Yeah, they're harder to find in the States, but they are readily available overseas. There, that's a good word. My tongue is getting twisted. But those are the two guns that I use. I've got another one up there and I don't know what the brand is and I don't like it, so we're not going to talk about what the brand is. I just don't like it.
It's called El Cheapo.
El Cheapo. These are about, what, 150, 160?
Yeah. The other one was like a $80 or $90.
Yeah, the other one was like an $80, $90 one, and you get what you pay for. These really work well, so. All right, razor blades. So I just use regular straight edge razor blades. Nothing fancy, right out of the box. Somebody was talking the other day, what the heck did they say they used that I thought was a good idea? Might have been you, Ragnar. What do you use to cut yours? It might have been the razor blades from...
Utility knife,
I think. It was the ones that are angled, right? Which have little points. So it just depends on your comfort level and what you want to use. I find these fine. You go through quite a bit of them, but Ragnar has a solution to sharpen hers. She uses her knife sharpener. I just keep going through them. So you just run them in there. And you want to make sure you have a sharp razor blade. If you're cutting and you hit a staple and it dulls, don't keep trying to force it because you'll end up making a mistake and cutting your fabric when you don't want to. And right there as it started to cut, I realized I did not have enough staples yet. So let's get those in there. Because once you cut, you get nothing to hang on to. Let's just make sure that we put enough staples in there. We, meaning me and my gun. Yeah, there's a few more spots. Because once you cut that off, you got nothing to hang on to. And if you lose it, you're starting over. There we go. Now I think I'm good. And where did the crazy lady sit her razor blade down, Bill?
Underneath.
Nope, I see it.
We got a nice close-up shot of that. So.
This okay. All right, so you guys can see now. So this is the channel, and I am just literally taking the razor blade and riding it right inside that groove. And it's easy to get pulling and slip and get something you don't want. Now I just hit a staple, so this is dull, so we're gonna go ahead and change that already. And we actually have a mayonnaise jar with a hole cut in the cover that we use for staples so that we just throw them in there. That way I don't have to worry about digging in the trash and getting cut on a staple, a razor. All right, let's turn this a little bit. Okay, cut on the inside is going to be a little trickier, just getting my body at the right angle here with the chair. Probably laying it on its side would be a good option. It's coming slow but sure. I'm deliberately going slow here because I don't want to slip and cut.
I would think if you'd reached in and started pulling back towards you, it would be easier, wouldn't it?
I can do that easy with this side, but the angle I'm at with this side, I'm not sure. We'll try it. Yeah, I can't get in there in the right angle.
That's why I don't upholster it.
Bill tears it down and makes it strong, and I make it pretty. So I just hit a staple again. Okay, Ragnar, I need you here with me sharpening razor blades. Here we go. All right, so now we cut the whole arm out. We have a hole in our fabric. Ta-da! What can we use that for? All right, now let's go ahead and trim the bottom outside, and as I get over to the other side, then we'll do that arm. Corner and come forward. making sure you guys can somewhat see me here. And I did go around, so I think I have plenty of staples in these areas. Did go around and check that before we went live. All right, so we got all the fabric removed from the bottom here. I'll go ahead and do the back. Cover all this area where I stapled, but I suppose being deconstructed, you really could leave this whole area without cording and just do the inside, but I'm thinking I like the idea. I've seen some where they actually stapled this up on top of the rails and then put a gimp or something up there. I've seen it where they've put decorative tacks. So there's many things. It's your imagination. So it's your piece, your imagination. Go for it. All right, so that is all trimmed down. Let's go ahead and do the second arm, and then we are ready to glue. And I just angled my holes all the way around my pedestal. Stripes lined up again. And now pull to the inside. And the inside channel on this arm seems to be a little narrower than the other one. Oops. There we go. All right, let's get the fronts done, and then instead of trimming this, I think we'll get started on our cording. Back. Definitely a little narrow on this side. Excuse me. I think I had one staple go outside my channel. Which means I'll probably have to touch up wood here.
We've got a few people that have the sail right along those, and they like that.
Okay.
As well, too, yeah.
Yeah, I've never tried that one, so good to know. Thank you.
Abby's anxious to get the video on how to do the lift table. It's, Abby, it's not really a detailed video on how to build it, but I do show you how to shim it up because that seems to be where everybody has the problem. But you'll see enough of it to figure out how to do it, and they're very simple.
And you talk about all the components, so yeah. Okay, so that is all ready to trim down. I probably need to fill in a few more staples, but let's get started gluing. I want to do that. So what's more exciting than watching paint dry? Watching glue dry. These out of the way. I'm gonna go ahead and lay this on its side. And actually, Bill, would you mind throwing me that chunk of foam that's over there and handing me the jute webbing? Because I forgot to bring them over here. Nope, I missed. I don't know if you want to throw that. He's going to throw the jute webbing at me. That could have been a disaster. All right, so that way it won't shift so much. Go ahead and start on the inside arm here. So I have got my cording all made up. I started serging one end of this because it's going to be for the cushion, the edge that's serged. So we're going to start at the opposite end. There we go. And then I need scissors and my glue gun. Glue gun stand over here, and this is just a cheapo glue gun that I got at a local hardware store, nothing fancy. I find that I go through them frequently when I'm using them a lot. Once they stop getting real hot, you really want them to get real hot, and if they don't get real hot, it's time to just throw it away and get a new one. They're only about 20 bucks or so, and you'll get quite a bit of use out of one before you have to heave it. Let me just move these. And then I always have a piece of scrap fabric of some sort to lay over my good fabric so we don't have to worry about dripping. And I think for this I'm going to start back in that back corner, so I don't know.
Where are you starting?
I'm starting in here, so. Oh. Sorry, I didn't give you a heads up. And I'm trimming this down to about a little bit less than a quarter an inch, I think. And we'll just start gluing it right in that groove. Get your groove on. You want a pair of real sharp scissors. These are my Kai scissors, which I believe you can get these on Amazon. We have them on our Amazon shop page. So I use Kai scissors for things like this, and then when I'm working with the big scissors, those are my Whisk scissors, and those are the two brands I seem to like the best. I have a few other brands, but those are my go-to scissors. And we actually, if you guys are curious about questions about upholstering a chair and the difference between recovering and reupholstering a chair and how much it costs to upholster a chair or why it costs so much to upholster a chair, I just put out a new blog post today that answers some of those questions, so I'd love to have you go check it out and give me your feedback. Join in on the conversation. So it's on our kimsupholstery.com website. All right, so let me just kind of test this first before we get started. So that little end will tuck in there. Those will go in the channel. And that's gonna look so pretty. You guys don't have a close-up shot, but that's gonna look really sharp. All right, let's get going. And so let me just test the glue gun on my little stand here. Yep, it's plenty hot enough. Oops, don't lose your cording, Kim, so you need that. Once the glue hits the chair, you wanna have your cording ready. And you really wanna go slow with your glue. Don't overdo it. And I suggest getting the feel for your glue gun before you start on your chair. You know what I forgot to have in my hand was my regulator, so I have to grab that in a second here. Because you want your regulator handy because it doesn't burn on your regulator like it does on your fingers. So you need to tuck your tails like I do right here. Also, if you get a spot of glue that pokes out, if you use the end of your regulator, you can usually save it and not make a mess. Do you have those days where you feel like you have two left hands? I think I'm having one of those. Now I don't suggest you go too far around of glue. Oops, and try to glue your cording in, go little bits at a time until you're really comfortable with it. And I've only done this about 1,000 times or more, so I tend to go a little bit longer than I suggest people just trying it for the first time do. Even steady stream of glue. Sit for a second. Switch this a little bit, so now we gotta come back down and around. The bottom. So I'm going to go ahead and run this down so I can find out where my cutoff point is. I'll cut it off somewhere in here. I should be good. It looks sharp. Can you guys see that? Yeah, you can see that stripe there. It looks really pretty against this fabric. I'm gonna pump this up just a little bit to do this bottom corner so I can really see what I'm doing. Okay, so that's as high as it goes. Lock it back up. Okay, now that I know where I am, I can cut off a little bit more here. Thank you. using my regulator to work the end of it down into the channel that's below the deck. There we go. All right, so we have one inside arm all done. Now we'll roll it onto its back and we'll do the inside back.
I would just stand it up and turn it around so everybody can see it.
Okay.
How it looks. We have a lot of time left.
Okay. Move my little props out of the way. Turn it so you guys can see. It's there, so it's coming all the way up from the deck, up and around, and disappearing back in the back side of the deck, so all through here. So what do you guys think? Did the stripe work out well? I did think about picking a solid color out of the fabric, but I really liked the stripe. Turn that so you can see a little better, maybe. How's that? So I'm gonna go ahead and finish the rest of this cording off camera, and next week we will do the cushion with you. I've got all the pieces cut out and the zipper is made and it's ready to assemble. So we'll sew that with you live next week, and I hope you'll stop by for that. And we will also have the chair so that you can see a picture of all the decorative cording in there. And if you're getting ready to start a deconstructed project of your own, we would love to hear what you're doing. For those of you that are members of our online classes, we will be live this afternoon at 3 o'clock for the Q&A session. So hop on over to the website at 3 o'clock, log into your member portal, and bring yourself a cup of coffee, cup of tea, glass of water, and join in on the conversation. So thanks everybody for stopping by, and we will see you right back here next week finishing the cushion. Have a good day, everybody.